I'm reading from 1 John chapter 4, from verse 7. The Bible tells us, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because God sent His only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through Him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so love us, we ought also to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time, but if we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and His love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in Him, and He in us, because He hath given us of His Spirit." I want to talk today on knowing God, loving God. Knowing God, loving God, because the two go together. You can't love God if you don't know God. And those who love God must know God. And so the two must go together, knowing God, loving God. The very essence of God's being, His personality, His nature is love. God is love. God must love, not sometimes, but all the time. God has to love. It is His nature that He must love. God's love must be manifested or make known or to be seen. God cannot hide His love from humanity. Amen. God cannot exist without loving. He must love. It is a must. The book of 1 John chapter 4 verse 9 says, "In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because that God sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through Him." Amen. Romans chapter 5 verse 8 tells us that, "But God commended His love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Jesus died for us." God's love was not shown or demonstrated based on our performance or that we deserve His love. As sinners, it was an opportunity to show and demonstrate His love. If there were no sinners, then there was not the love of God to be demonstrated. In the same principle, if there is no darkness, light is not effective. Light can only be effective when there is darkness. And so in the midst of sin, that God must demonstrate His love for sinners. So we did not deserve it, absolutely not. But it is because of God's love for us that He sent His only begotten Son to die on a cross for us. So as sinners, it was an opportunity to demonstrate or show His love. We were enemies of God, strangers to the commonwealth of God, but yet even though that we were strangers and aliens from God, yet God showed His love. When I think about God's love and begin to understand God's love and the depth of God's love, it just blows my mind. I just cannot comprehend it. I don't believe our finite mind could ever understand or come to knowledge or come to grasp of the depths of God's love that we are talking about. And as we go along, you begin to understand, begin to know more of God's love. The more you know of God's love, it's the more that you would love Him. The more you spend time with Him, it's more that you're going to love Him. And so I pray today that people get to know God more and more every single day, and then you would demonstrate your love towards Him. God and humans really is just the greatest love story that could ever find, better than all the love stories that the world could ever find. It is a true love story that you need to understand. It's not fiction. It's not a fairy tale, as people say. This love, it is a wonderful love that every single human being must experience. It shows in John chapter 3 and verse 16. The Bible tells us, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And so it is the intention that God would give you, you would have everlasting life by accepting or receiving the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Jesus himself says, he says, listen, don't call me Lord if you don't do what I say. He says, if you do what I say, then you can call me Lord. And so I believe in my heart that God is really, really wants you to get involved in what he is doing. So God so loves you now. Jesus really is the love gift to all of humanity. Amen. Jesus is the love gift. You have a gift this Christmas time. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. He is God's love gift to all of humanity. It is a free gift. Everybody can have it. It's free. You don't have to pay for it. Why don't you receive the gift that God has given to you? Because of his love that he demonstrated. He said, I give you Jesus so he can die on the cross for all of humanity. Now, there's something that I need you to understand this. There's something about the meaning of the word love, and I go a little slow. You need to understand the meaning of the word or the word love or understand God's love. Because if you do not understand love, L-O-V-E, we're going to find ourselves all confused about love when we say, I love you. You don't understand what I'm saying about I love you. When I say I love you with God's love, there is certainly a difference. So I want to say I love you with God's love. And you're going to understand this now as you listen carefully. Now, the English language really does not express the depth of the word L-O-V-E. Go a little slower so you can understand that. So the English language doesn't really show you the depth of the word L-O-V-E in comparison with the Greek or the Hebrew meaning for the word love or the original word for it. The English language cannot express it whatsoever. Now, you need to understand God's love, and we're going to go, and I'm going to show you some of the depths of God's love. God's love is really what you call the agape love. And you put that into your spirit. He says the agape love. This is God's love. It's a divine love. It's the highest and most perfect love. It's the highest and most perfect love. Now, you have second degree love, which is called filial love. Filial love, this is really human love, and it is inferior to agape love or God's love. The filial love, really, or the filial function is based on moods and emotions. Every day you can see the filial in operation. I can say this without a shadow of a doubt. People say, I love you today and hate tomorrow. That's the filial. He said, I love you today and divorce tomorrow. That's the filial. He said, we are friends today and enemies tomorrow. That's the filial. God's love is in direct opposition to the filial. So what the world understand really is more of human love. It's more of a filial love, and they don't have an idea about the greatest love and the highest love that you can ever find. It's called the agape love or the divine love of God. Now, there is what you call the lowest level of love that really captivates the entire world today. It's called the Eros love. Eros love is really sexual love. And so people confused, they are so confused in respect to sexual love, filial love, and God's love. And so the thing that Eros love really is the highest love whatsoever, because of the, it takes you into really high emotions or feelings that people think, listen, that's the highest that one can reach in respect to love. But really and truly, it is the lowest level of love that you can find, a lowest degree of love. And so we need to understand that. Don't get confused with the agape love, the filial love, or the eros love. Never get confused with that. Now you're going to find the majority of the world has placed a very high value on the lowest level of love. Amen. I said the majority of the world has put value, most value, in the lowest level of love, that really it is so low that it's destroying the world today. Eros love, which is very, very serious, and we need to get that into our spirit. Most people marry based on eros. And so once they marry based on eros, that's going to fail. Most people marry based on filio, that is going to fail. All other love that is inferior to the agape love will fail. The filio will fail. How many people after they marry in the filio, that is marry based on human emotions and human love, so to speak, and after a while, 10 years passed, not even 10 years, 1 year passed, and it seems as though that the love is not there. It seems as though there is no feelings and there is no something attaching to them. There's no twinkling inside and no tinkling inside of the heart, so to speak. So the marriages begin to flop even from the very beginning of the first year of marriage. That's filio. Filio will fail because it's inferior to the agape eros, to the lowest level of love, which the world have put the highest value on. That is also going to fail. So the enemy, Satan, knows that. In today's world, look, check out the movies, you check out the advertisement. They are all based on eros. They are based on sexual love. That's what sexual is all about. The devil is using eros or sexual love to deceive people to think that eros is really the highest love whatsoever human could ever attain. He uses what the billion-dollar business of pornography. And people don't talk about pornography, but pornography is actually attacking every single person, from old people to young people to even children. Pornography is a very dangerous thing, and it is destroying the world and destroying all of humanity. People don't want to talk about it, but it's a multi-billion-dollar industry, probably the biggest industry in the world today, that is captivating the minds of people, and people easily can get into their computer. Computers are so easy to get in there. It's easily available for anybody who wants it. It's only just to have one click on it and you get it. Amen? Are you understanding me? Now, when the enemy uses this pornography or billion-dollar industry of pornography, he wants to pervert the minds of human to change the natural use of sexual love that God really created. God created sex. I believe God created sex as a pleasurable thing. It's not the highest, really, pleasure you talk about. It is when you really have pleasure in God and receive God's love, then you would understand what pleasure is all about. There is great pleasure when you have God's love inside of you. When you experience God's love, sexual love become really the lowest level of it. But God still created sexual love in human beings that they can have pleasure with. But the mind of people, because of the enemy Satan has been using that to pervert the minds of people. And so they have gone away from the natural use of sex or the eros love, so to speak. And they have gone into all kinds of perversion. God have given to them a reprobate mind, and so sex is in all kinds of crazy way. They have changed all kinds of things concerning sex. They have sex with animals, women with women, men with men, and even with young children. These things are not to be so. They're wrong in the sight of God, and as a result of that, judgment comes upon the land when all these things are happening. So you need to understand that Jesus came that we might have life and that we might have it more abundantly. He wants to give us a sound mind, a sober mind, not a reprobate mind, a mind that is so perverted that we actually think that the kind of sexual thing that you have around the world today is really taken into the highest level of love. But it is not the highest level of love. It is the lowest level of love that the Bible talks about. Amen. Now, the Apostle Peter was confused about love when Jesus asked him the question, "Do you love me?" You're going to find that in John chapter 21. You're going to understand what Jesus is talking about. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Now, in John chapter 21 and verse 15, I want to read from there. He said, "And so when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, he says, 'Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me more than these?' He said unto him, 'Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee.' He said unto him, 'Feed my lambs.'" Verse 16, "And he said unto him again the second time, 'Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me?' He said unto him, 'Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee.' He said unto him, 'Feed my sheep.' He went on to say again, he said unto him the third time, 'Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me?' And Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, 'Lovest thou me?' And he said unto him, 'Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee.' And Jesus said unto him, 'Feed my sheep.'" Now, you need to understand what was happening here. Jesus interviewed the Apostle Peter on the shore of Tiberias. Sets before him or set before us the most beautiful way or the shades and degrees of the Greek meaning of the word love. Three times Jesus asked the question to Simon Peter. He said, do you love me, Peter, more than these? Do you love me, Peter, more than these? Do you love me, Peter, more than these? And every time Jesus was asking the question, he was asking the question in the agape, and Peter was responding in the filio. That's the reason why Jesus was asked the question three times. He says, Peter, do you love me as God love you? Do you love me as the same way God loves you? Do you love me in the same way? Now, and Peter answering in the human form, he's answering in the filio. And so Peter did not even understand about the agape. It was very much confusion. And so the entire humanity is confused concerning this particular thing. You need to understand what is happening here in the situation. And so he answering the human affection with strong feelings of sentiment. So a woman asks a man without the agape love, he says, do you love me? And so that woman answer in the filio. And so the man asks the same question, the woman asks the same question. They all answer in the filial because they have no idea what the agape love is really about. So most people today, they're actually say, I love you, I love you. They're really saying or answering, yes, I love you in the filial. It's always based on emotions. You see, when the filial is in operation, as the emotions go and the moods go, that's how you operate. You get vexed sometimes. You pelt over the plate sometimes, you argue sometimes, you don't come home for a couple of days. That's what how the filio operates, human emotions, so to speak. But the agape is quite different. The agape is something and the love that actually you love despite the fact of the situation. When you love in the agape, there is nothing about inferiority. You really love with the love of God. And that's the love that I want you to know. I want every single person to know when you talk about the love of God. Are you understanding me now? Now, in Matthew chapter 26, verse 65 and 75, I just give you a summary here. You see, the Bible tells us that Jesus was with the disciples spending time with him. And so when you understand, Peter didn't really experience the agape love. Anytime a man experienced agape love, his life will never be the same again. And so they were sitting together and Jesus told them, he said, you know what? I am going to go to the cross. I'm going to die and all that stuff. And Peter said, listen, he feel very much offended about that. And so Jesus said, you know, someone is going to betray me. Someone is going to deny me. And Peter jumped up very quickly. He's talking in the emotions. Yes, I love you, Jesus, but I love you from a human point of view. I love you in the filio. And so immediately he says, he jumps up very quickly. You see, humans say some stuff based on love. Say, I love you, but we say some stuff, but we don't really mean what we say because it's inferior to what we say about love. And so he says now, he said, Jesus, I want you to know, I will not deny you at all. I'm going to follow you until the end. I mean, until death, I am going to follow you. I'm going to go if death has to come. I'm going to die for you. Now, that's only the human part of it. How many people say they're going to die when they're going to get married and they're saying their vows? I'm going to die for you. As soon as some problem comes, you take off. You're the first one to take off because it's filio. It's not agape. When you are in the agape, you're going to stick it out. It doesn't matter what you're going to. It doesn't matter whether you have food to eat, you're going to stick it out. Whatever problems that come your way, you see, you're going to stick it out until death do us part. That's what we vowed to when we actually got married. But it's not working like that anymore because people are answering, I love you in the filio. They're getting married in the filio, and most of them are getting married based on the errors because they look at the person and look at their situation, look at their job and look at their money and look at their figure and look at their status, and that's how they get married. That's why marriages are not standing today, because they're not married in the right kind of love. You have to get married in the agape love, the love of God inside of you, and the love is still going to go on once you're still loving in the Lord God Almighty. And so we need to understand what happened here. And so Peter acted. Jesus told Peter, he said, Peter, he said, I want you to know, before the rooster crow, you're going to deny me three times. Before, not me, Jesus, not how we talk about that way in the human love. Not me, I swear, and sometimes we curse like Peter. Peter was with the Lord. He was with the Lord. And the Bible tells us that Peter denied the Lord by saying, I don't know you, Jesus. Can you imagine that? What kind of love is that? I mean, I don't know who you are. And that's human love that has been manifested here. He said, I do not know you, Jesus. I was never in the company with him. He took an oath, he swore, and even cursed. That's the same man who says, Jesus, I will never deny you. Jesus, I'm going to go down to the end. If you die, I'm going to die with you. And not long after, it wasn't long after, a couple hours here, when they confront him, he says, I don't know him. I never been in company with him. And he swore, and he curse and take an oath. This is human love or affection at work, and this is not going to work. It's not going to keep society together. It's not going to keep marriages together. It's not going to keep the family together. It's not going to keep a church together. It's not going to keep the nation together if we operate in the filial, because you would say, just like Simon Peter, we'll deny the Lord and we deny people. There is no genuine love in it. It is very selfish. There is no foundation, and it will fail. According to 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8, the Bible tells us, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. He said, he that loveth not, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. You can't love God if you don't know him. You can't say, I love God, because, and if you don't know him, that's an impossibility according to the scripture. You cannot say, I love God if you don't know him. You must know God to love him. You can't say that I love somebody. These days it's quite different. You see somebody, you don't even know that person. I love that person. That's not love, that's lost. Lost is different from love. And then when you actually get together and you begin to know that person and begin to see some bad habits in them, and begin to see some traits that is not, you're not, it's not likable, then of course you begin to actually say, I don't love that person no more, because you never took time off to know that person. You see, you got to know who God is before you love him. You cannot love God, you cannot say that you love God if you don't know him. If you never had a personal, intimate relationship with God, don't ever say that you love God, because you didn't never know him. You need to know God. That's what the scripture is saying. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. You can't love God if you don't know him. According to Matthew chapter 22 and verse 35 to 40, the Bible tells us, a lawyer asked Jesus, he said, which is the greatest commandment of the law? And he answers, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your might. Let me say that again. The greatest, the first and greatest commandment is that Jesus answered. He said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thine mind, with all thy soul. He didn't say, he is not talking about the filial love. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God in the filial, that level of Lord, that level of love. No, he's saying, you shall love me, you shall love God Almighty with the agape love, the divine love of God, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, with everything that is in you. And you need to get that into your spirit. He says, now, this is the first and greatest commandment. So it is a command to all human beings to love the Lord with all their hearts, not some of it. You can love God with some of your heart and give him a piece of the heart and say, God, I give you a piece of the heart on Sunday morning, and of course tomorrow is Wednesday, and Lord, I give you another piece of my heart, or I don't give you no heart at all. God, that is unacceptable. That is unacceptable. You hear me on the airways? That is unacceptable. Now, that is not right to you. You say, either you give God your all or you don't give him any at all. And you need to get that right into your spirit. And I say that again and again and again and again. All right? The Lord, you have to love the Lord thy God, not with some of your heart, but with all. If we love God with some of our heart, he will not accept it. He will reject it. You can be coming to church and you can be serving God in whatever way you want, and you saying, Lord, I love you, but it's not with all your heart. Forget it. I am saying this and I'm not afraid to say it. I'm saying it very strongly. I may not be a likable preacher, but the thing about it, that's it. That's what God says. He cannot lie. And he demands demands that kind of love. He said, you're going to love him with your all, not just some of your heart. He says, I want your all. I want your all. And if you're willing to give me your all, then I will accept it. You need to get out of your spirit. So it is either all the heart or none. Love God with your all. God must be first and supreme object of man's love. He must be the first and supreme object of man's love. He must be loved with our all. Why? You may ask yourself the question, why God is saying to love me with your all? You see, you need to understand this. Whatever you love more than God will destroy you. Whatever you love, and I'm going slow in that, whatever you love more than God will destroy you. Whatever you love, you see, God created the heart for himself. He wants to sit on the throne of your heart. Anything that has space in the heart that you give God, 99% of your heart, that one thing that you love, put aside, you say, I'm going to love this 1%. That's the area you're going to give Satan a loophole to come in. And he's going to come in there and he's going to work in it and he'll take more of the percentage of your heart. Eventually, he's going to get into your heart and take your whole heart and then destroy you. You need to get that into your spirit. That's what the Bible tells us now. Are you understanding me now? When you understand, there are some examples in the Bible where people give to the enemy something to work with. The Bible tells us about a man called Judas, who was a man sitting right with God. He was the treasurer of Jesus' ministry, but he used to always dip his hand into the treasury and steal money. Jesus knew that he was a thief. He says that he was a thief. So Jesus allowed him to stay there. And so Judas really loved money. He loved money. But you know, God could have supplied and take care of all his needs, but because he loved money and never took that to the Lord and say, help me in that situation. That same thing that he loved the most, he loved money more than God. He loved money to the point of betraying Jesus. He loved money to the point whereby he sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver, the price of a slave. That's how much he loved money. And because he loved money, that's when he was destroyed. So we need to get that very, very straight. We understand that clearly. Money definitely. And to those who look at this telecast, do you really know Jesus? Do you really want to know him? You have an opportunity right now to know Jesus, because if you don't know Jesus, you can't love him. Those who know it, do not know God, cannot love God. And so I pray that you open up yourself right where you are, that God is going to come in. If you just give me a moment of time and allow Jesus to come into your life, your life is going to change right now. He's going to pour his Holy Spirit in your life. And he's going to pour out the love of God inside of you. And you're going to be changed and demonstrate the love of God. If you're like that today and watching me right now, I want to pray for you in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you, Lord, for those who have viewed this program. And I ask, Lord, for those who really need Jesus in their life, that God, you'll share your Holy Ghost upon them as they receive the Lord right now. And you're going to pour out the love of God in their hearts. Those who used to hate will love now. Those who couldn't love their enemies are going to love now, because the love of God have done something. They're going to know you more and more and love you more. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Clap your hands to the Lord. God is good.